evening. My name is Margaret Tamulonis, and I am the chair of the Center for Research on Vermont, their executive committee. I also work at the Fleming Museum here at UVM. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the second Samuel B. Hand annual lecture. Truly my pleasure. I'm so glad to see you all here. We have an excellent program for you tonight, but I have a few announcements and thank yous before we get started. First of all, this program is a joint effort of the Center and the Vermont Historical Society. I'd like to thank VHS Director Steve Perkins and Amanda Gustin from the Historical Society for their work. Please wave. I know, Amanda, you're holding a camera, but thank you so much. We're so grateful for the collaboration. I'd also like to thank our Dean, William Falls, for his support of the center. That's really important. And to recognize Kristen Peterson-Ishak, who served as the center's coordinator for more than 30 years. And I'm so glad to see you here this evening. Thank you. And of course, RETN for filming this. Thank you, as always. I'd also like to thank Richard Watts, the director of the Center for Research on Vermont, for all of his work for the center and for Vermont research. So Richard, thank you. All right. Thank you all for the applause. 1974, as we will soon hear, was an important year. It was also the year that the center was founded. A universal scholar and historian, Sam Hand was one of the original Gang of Six that founded the center in 1974. I'd like to ask Nick Muller, co-founder of the center in 1974, and a good friend and colleague of Sam's, to come up and say a few words. Nick is a historian and scholar who has written a number of books and scholarly articles about Vermont and a former director of the Vermont Historical Society. So please join me in welcoming Nick.
Nice to see you.
Lovely to see you. Do you want the microphone?
I don't know. Can you hear me?
No.
Yes, sir. I was not the director of the Vermont Historical Society. I've been a trustee, a vice president, a treasurer, and I'm now the lone honorary trustee, which tells you that my lifespan is probably pretty close to the end. I'd like to tell you a little bit about Sam Hand, a colleague of mine when I was teaching history here. He came to the University of Vermont after service in the Korean War, working on a doctorate at Syracuse University, and one terrible year at Slippery Rock College. And boy, were he and Harriet happy to get to Burlington and to the University of Vermont. He came here as a New Deal scholar. He worked in his dissertation, and he's published about Judge Samuel Rosamond, a longtime advisor, speechwriter, and friend of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. When he got here, of course, he discovered that Vermont was not particularly strong for the New Deal. And there were not archival materials available for prominent New Dealers coming from Vermont. And he got hooked up with Jay Gould, then chairman of the political science department. And they were both interested in the administration of law or justice, and also how politics worked. And with Jay, he got going on doing research and publishing about the Mountain Rule, about judges and the early court in Vermont. He worked with others like Greg Sanford, who I regret is not here tonight, on Nathaniel Chipman, lay judges. He got involved that way. I taught Vermont history here from 1966 through 1978. And when I left to go elsewhere, after 2 years, Sam took over teaching Vermont history. And together, the two of us published a book that was the readings that I had developed, but really Sam was the one who brought it to fruition. As he began to work in Vermont's past, he published two major books. One, The Star That Set, on the history of the Republican Party. A second, he was the instigator with Steve Terry and eventually Anthony Merrill on a biography of Phil Hoff, with whom Sam had worked a long time as a good friend. The Rutland Herald called Sam Hand the Dean of Vermont Historians, and he earned that accolade. Always made me a little jealous. He's been recognized by the U.S. Congress, and I would like to ask Sally Hand, his daughter, would come here and present the citation that came from the Congress. Do you want this? You want it.
When my father retired, Senator Leahy put a piece in the Congressional Record, which was hanging in my parents' house until they both died. And it's entitled, Dr. Samuel B. Hand, University of Vermont, Professor of History Emeritus. And it basically is what we put in the Free Press for his obituary. But I figured if people want to look at it later, it'll be up here, and it now hangs in my house. So thank you.
Thank you, Sally. Sam Hand had a great sense of humor, but it was never scatological. It was different and fun. And I have a little story to tell you about Sally and Sam and Harriet, his wife and her mother. Sally worked for the Library of Congress, and Sam and Harriet were visiting in Washington, and she had a little soiree for them. And one of her friends came up to Sam and said, Professor Hand, I could tell you from Vermont. You have the same accent as Bernie Sanders. True? It's a delight to be here for me and for many others. And the second, now we can call it annual Samuel B. Hand Lecture. It's become annual, and I think it's going to grow over time. Very much appreciate the opportunity to talk about Sam with you all and to turn this back over.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Philip Baruth for our presentation tonight. He is a professor of English at the University of Vermont, where he served on the faculty since 1993. Philip is the author of 4 novels and more than a dozen published short stories, as well as screenplays, radio commentaries, and works of scholarship. His most recent novel, The Brothers Boswell, was included on the Washington Post list of best books of 2009. It was also an Indie Next List notable book. His novel, The Ex-President, was a New York Times Notable Book of 2003. In 1994, Baruth won the Black Warrior Review Annual Fiction Prize for his short story, Pea Heart. He is currently at work on a biography of Senator Patrick Leahy. Please join me in welcoming Philip Baruth.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much.
So I'm not sure, I have several mics on for people in the room and people not yet in the room. Can you hear me now? Okay, great. Thank you everyone for being here. I just want to say that you are the first people to see this cover. This is the actual cover, University Press of New England, designed for the biography, which is finished and which will be coming out in April. So you're also the first people to hear certain parts of this. A little bit of what I'm going to read to you, I read maybe 3 years ago, but I'm going to add a little more tonight just for you. So if you think about Patrick Leahy and you think about the famous images of him that you know, I would be willing to bet that these images are the most famous. And I want to begin by playing this for you.
be damned. You know where Harvey is? You know who he is?
Do you know where I can find Harvey? I need to talk to him about something. Just something little, huh? No. You know, I'll settle for his loved ones.
We're not intimidated by thugs.
You know, you remind me of my father. I hated my father.
Okay. As I say, far and away the most famous image of Patrick Leahy. Hundreds of millions of people saw this film and saw our senior senator. I happened to see this film in Stockholm, Sweden, with an audience of very appreciative Swedes. And I asked myself on that night as I came out of the theater, how did Pat Leahy wind up in The Dark Knight? I had that question in my mind. And I also had the question, why was Pat Leahy targeted in 2001 by the anthrax mailer? And so with those two questions, I started looking into Pat Leahy, and I found way far back in his career a much different film that I would imagine almost none of you have seen. And I want to show that to you. This is a film from 1974. And it was made by a filmmaker named Dorothy Todd. And it was, my research indicates, the main reason in the final days why Patrick Leahy surged into the lead. Not quite sure why these are dark now.
No worries.
This is Austin, who has been phenomenal helping me. Okay, we've got something. The perils of high tech. So this was a film produced with the intent of acting as a firewall in the final weeks of Leahy's 74 campaign. And he was down, according to a famous poll called the Naramore poll, he was down 10 points until this ran in prime time.
Wonderful. We need your help.
Well, delighted to see you, and I certainly wish you well.
Yeah, Dad, come on over.
George, you're pretty sporty there with that outfit.
I went to Governor's ball and somebody left me, so I come. That's where I get it.
George, you don't change. You don't change.
I don't want to.
You know, so far in this campaign, we've driven between 25,000 and 30,000 miles. I think between my wife and myself, we've been in practically every town in the state of Vermont.
This year, we will choose a new senator for Vermont. Senator George Aiken is leaving Washington after a long career of distinguished independent service. This is the story of the 1974 Vermont Senate campaign, Vermont's people, their problems, and one candidate, Patrick Leahy.
I find that people have very much the same concerns, no matter where they live in the state of Vermont, no matter what their political affiliations are. They're not satisfied with the way Congress has been acting. They feel the economy is getting out of hand, and it's hurting people in middle income, people low income, way out of proportion to those with high incomes. They're concerned that there's a double standard of justice. They feel that this administration has one set of justice for itself, a different set of justice, different standard of justice for the rest of the people. And it bothers them an awful lot. I've never seen so many troubled people in Vermont before in my life.
And I think people are very, very concerned. I think they're frightened.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is a taste of the campaign film from 1974 that Dorothy Todd brought into being and actually moved Pat Leahy's numbers, arguably, 12 points in 10 days, which was stunning. So I started to ask myself, how did all of these pieces go together? And I eventually wrote an introduction, part of which I will read you now, called Leahy Media Anthrax Batman. And what I mean by that particular combination is, is if you study Leahy's career, you can't get away from the fact that every single piece of it is drawn together with every other piece via a dominant media perception of Leahy. And that's a media image that was generated originally, very specifically, for the 74 campaign. Paul Brune, who I don't see in the room, Leahy's campaign manager, sat for me for a number of hours talking about that campaign. And what was most interesting about it was how purposeful and thoughtful that image creation was. So what I'd like to do is tonight read you three snippets from the book in which I talk about the ways in which media stitches together what Leahy has done with the Batman franchise. He's been in five of those films at this point, as well as narrating and writing several Batman comics. So a lot of work in that franchise, the way that connects with this early 74 film and the rest of his media posture from then to now. I'll leave out Anthrax. You'll have to buy the books to do that. So again, this is from the introduction, Leahy Media Anthrax Batman. Patrick Leahy's immersion in popular culture, particularly the Batman franchise, has been much trumpeted by the media, but very little analyzed and even less understood. Every new Batman role has ignited a sunburst of whimsical publicity, almost all of it in the form of puns and puffs couched tediously in Robin speak. In 2008, the New York Times ran with, "Holy cameo, Batman, it's a senator," while Vermont's Rutland Herald, Thesaurus at the Ready, slugged their own puff piece, "Holy Solon, Batman." Inevitably, Leahy's bit parts are portrayed as a joyful sort of dilettantism, a harmless sentimentality for the comic books of his youth. And this determined lack of interpretation, Leahy himself has encouraged by pairing the film openings with readings for children at the Kellogg Hubbard Library, where Leahy read as a kid and to which he now generously donates all royalties from his film appearances. And of course, Leahy's delight in the world of the Hollywood blockbuster does derive in part from sentimentality, and it is a relic of his Rockwell-ready childhood, reading Batman comics in Montpelier, Vermont, at least on one level. But to see Leahy's durable presence in the Batman narrative as the result of only those elements, as accidental or beside the political point, is to fail to grasp one of the most basic principles by which Patrick Leahy functions, and has always functioned, ever since his quixotic 1974 challenge of an incumbent Republican congressman for a Senate seat that had never once in history gone Democratic. Leahy's entire career has been built painstakingly around the crucial daily work of the prosecutor and the Judiciary Committee chairman, but also and always the accompanying trope of the crime fighter, the powerful crusader for order and public safety, what Paul Brune, manager of the 74 Senate campaign, would eventually come to call the top cop image. As a Chittenden County state's attorney, Leahy had learned the ins and outs of prosecuting the worst that the state's most populous county had to offer. As a dark horse candidate for the U.S. Senate 8 years later, he and his team managed to diffuse that top cop image throughout the totality of Vermont's truncated media landscape in ways that confounded his opponents and radically distended the technological boundaries of the moment. But more than any other single element, it would be a professional campaign film that would finally put Leahy over the top in 1974. A 30-minute documentary that showcased the young state's attorney and his considerable Vermont roots, all the while drawing subtly on the popular crime dramas of the day. Director Dorothy Todd called it, quote, the Leahy Walton film, an affectionate comparison to CBS's long-running family drama, The Waltons, and an acknowledgement of its careful yet lavish deployment of sentimentality. Leahy himself would inevitably refer to the film as the blockbuster, and he counted on it as his final firewall in an election he seemed doomed, even in the final days, to lose. In a very real sense, Todd's blockbuster helped make Pat Leahy the powerful Washington icon he is today. That other blockbusters of varied genre might later enhance that stature, Leahy seems to have guessed at very early on. But that a specific connection to the Batman narrative could dramatically ink and color the outlines of his prosecutor's image, that popular culture could in fact undergird and drive political culture, Leahy recognized immediately as a self-evident sociological fact. Leahy was the first Democrat ever elected to the US Senate from Vermont, in other words, not alone because he was a skilled professional with a very strong track record in criminal justice, although that he absolutely was, but because he was also more than willing to be actively constructed as a hero, to be the top cop, not merely in the street-level reality of Chittenden County, but also in the greater evolving imaginary of post-Watergate Vermont. This confluence Leahy achieves half-consciously, as has been his wont from the beginning, but when looking at his life in totality, the signature approach is impossible to miss, especially by contrast to politicians more traditional and less adaptable in the historical scheme of things. Dick Mallory, Congressman Dick Mallory, his front-running GOP opponent in 1974, was clearly stunned by Leahy's deft and aggressive media push. But more generally, Mallory was put off by the increasingly intimate reach of campaign coverage itself, and by the power that the media had to drive campaigns rather than vice versa. Quote, it was clear that the kind of campaign involving in Vermont that was so media heavy was not a place where Dick Mallory was at ease, says Candace Page, a senior Burlington Free Press reporter who covered Vermont's first post-Watergate election. Not so the dark horse who surged past him in the final days of the race. Even in the early 1970s, Pat Leahy knew deep down that this coming new world was undeniably for him. This intensely public sparring and self-fashioning, this immersion in and dispersal through media. Evolution is only achieved by mutation, and in this case, it was as though Leahy had been born with an uncanny, almost prehensile grip on broadcast technologies that most politicians still handled only clumsily and occasionally. Political scientist Garrison Nelson sees it as no accident that Leahy was the first politician post-World War II to win statewide office without going through Montpelier or climbing the traditional statewide ladder. Quote, Patrick grasped the role of media before anyone, Nelson says. Print journalism in Vermont focused heavily on lawmakers in Montpelier, but he knew that Channel 3 could beam him statewide every night. And in the competition between print journalism and broadcast, who wins? Broadcast wins, end quote. Leahy's nickname for the 74 campaign film captures at once his politician's shrewd grasp of the box office power there, but also his utterly ingenuous love of the medium itself, of the movies and the heroes that animate them. It was and remains today a uniquely populist and anti-elitist ethic. Leahy has always evinced a characteristically postmodern joy in transgressing and obliterating such boundaries. It is a lifelong approach that has enabled Leahy to adapt smoothly over the decades to ride out Vermont's own relatively rapid transformation from quintessential red state to swing state to its position currently among the most consistently Democrat of the blue. And it helped to position Leahy in the aftermath of 9/11 and the all but unprecedented political and policy overreach of the Bush administration as a de facto alternative to the tough-talking Texan in the White House. This biography centers quite purposefully on those years when the small, rural state of Vermont suddenly emerged as the home of something like a shadow administration and arguably the wintertime refuge of civil liberties in the United States of America. That's the first snippet and the end of what I'll read from the introduction. This next part is a little introduction to the race in 1974, and you will notice a surprise appearance by Bernie Sanders. Let's be precise. It was not, technically speaking, impossible for Patrick Leahy to be elected over Richard Walker Mallory to the United States Senate from the state of Vermont in the year 1974. But the fact of its eventual narrow possibility has come over the decades to almost entirely obscure the outcome's complete and utter implausibility. Pat Leahy should not have been elected to the Senate in 1974, that is to say, by any realistic reading of the challenges he faced. His contemporaries can certainly be excused for having laughed at his chances, because in point of fact, those chances were laughable. And laugh they did. Brian Harwood, one of Mallory's campaign managers, sums up the prevailing wisdom with a fairly intimate moment from a key campaign strategy session at a restaurant in southern Vermont. Quote, "I'm standing in the men's room at this place down in Queechee next to Al Moulton, and we're there at the urinals, and Al said, 'So, what do you think of this guy Leahy?' And I just laughed and said, 'Ah, pay no attention at all. Nobody knows him outside of Chittenden County. Forget about it.'" End quote. There were a host of reasons to forget about it, of course, but among those were three paramount handicaps, any of which alone would have been enough to doom Leahy's candidacy. Taken together, they were clearly an electoral death sentence, and a sentence stronger than the sum of its parts at that, because each unelectable trait seemed only to leverage the next. In ascending order of unacceptability, then, Leahy was very young, very much a Catholic, and worst of all, from a historical perspective, he was a Democrat. When he announced his candidacy on March 1st, 1974, Leahy was just 33 years old, a relative political novice. Vermonters preferred their senators a good bit longer in the tooth. No one under 50 had ever represented the state in that capacity. And the smart money on both sides suspected that Leahy knew that as well as anyone. More than a few insiders saw this 1974 run as broadly sacrificial, merely designed to build name recognition for a later, more serious run at Attorney General. Yes, with his height, gruff baritone, and purely symbolic comb-over, Leahy seemed a good deal older than his 33 years. Dick Mallory, Leahy's GOP opponent, was himself a bit young by historical standards, at just 45. By even his own campaign's admission, Mallory was never truly comfortable in campaign mode. Quote, "Mallory was the quintessential New Englander," says Free Press reporter Candace Page, "rock-ribbed, Protestant, Hilltown New Englander, stoic, and a little prim. He came across as almost a New England preacher," end quote. But of course, Mallory had a proven and impressive track record at the ballot box, and he was currently Vermont's lone representative, having won a special election during the previous cycle. Whatever his personal quirks, Mallory was a genuine and respected statewide personality with near universal name recognition and ready access to the front pages of the daily papers. And it's an unvarnished historical fact that Vermonters as a whole also still preferred that their elected officials be Protestant. In fact, former Governor Phil Hoff, who snapped a 108-year losing streak for Democrats when he scored a stunning upset in the gubernatorial race of 1962, which I learned a great deal about from Sam Hand's book, thank you very much, Sam, was himself chosen by party elders, partially with an eye toward reassuring conservative Protestant voters wary of his Democratic bona fides. Quote, "Jack Spencer, chairman of the Democratic Party, had a very firm idea of the kind of person he thought could win," Hoff notes. "He recruited me because he wanted a person who was progressive, enthusiastic, and Protestant." Most to the point, though, and least to his advantage at the ballot box, Leahy was an outspoken Democrat, and Vermonters sent Republicans to the Senate, and only Republicans. Since 1866, when Congress had mandated that state legislatures elect senators by an absolute majority, those majorities had stood rock solid with the GOP. In 1974, Vermont was still one of the absolutely reddest states in the Union. Richard Nixon, as he anxiously counted votes in the run-up to his possible impeachment trial, would certainly have seen the state as some of the most reliable masonry in his firewall. As former Governor Hoff succinctly put it, starting not too long after the Civil War, Democrats marched to the polls and got murdered, absolutely murdered every time. And as though that weren't quite enough in the way of insurmountable obstacles, Leahy would also eventually face a spirited long shot challenge from the left in the form of one Bernard Sanders, the Liberty Union Party's highly outspoken 32-year-old nominee. While Liberty Union, forerunner to the state's Progressive Party, had over the years proven chronically unable to break the 5% mark, Sanders himself had recently had a great deal of success in challenging an eye-popping 38% rate increase by New England Telephone. On the heels of that success, and banking on his already well-known ability to question closely and speak unflinchingly, the Liberty Union standard bearer was intent on reaching 10% of the vote in the November election. Sanders, who, as the Free Press politely noted, quote, speaks with somewhat of a Brooklyn accent, end quote, had a penchant for attacking not merely the Rockefellers and corporate titans, but the Democratic and Republican parties both for what he saw as complicity in, quote, socialism for the rich. So here was the last of the rapids that Leahy would have to run. Liberty Union would be targeting anti-war liberals and other long-standing Democratic constituencies. It was an excellent assumption that a corrupt White House might make it a growth year for a reformist third party. Asked in 2011 if there was any attempt on the part of the Leahy campaign to persuade Bernie Sanders to forego a run and unify the left behind a Democrat, Paul Bruhn allows himself a very small smile and demurs, quote, as Bernie is today, so was he then, end quote. All of which left Republican Congressman Dick Mallory very much in the catbird seat. And from that controlling position atop those many stacked advantages, Mallory made one decision that more than any other would help to create the basic dynamic of the race. Rather than match Leahy's early start, Mallory would very deliberately go the other way. He would make a point of staying down in Washington and legislating, as the voters had elected him to do, and come home only on weekends to campaign. It was the right thing to do, Mallory declared, and that was that. Needless to say, it was a decision that gave his strategists a great deal of pause. As Leahy was nothing if not hungry, and having the state's tiny retail political events more or less to himself for 7 months would give the Democrat plenty of room to make his case. Yet Leahy's decision was, quote, principled, they felt, in keeping with both the reality and the campaign's preferred image of their congressman. But as it happened, there were extraordinary factors about Patrick Leahy that Mallory and his small inner circle could not and did not take into account. It's fair to say that they had never seen anything like Pat Leahy's particular sort of hunger before, a fire in the belly that could only be called incandescent. And they didn't at first fully appreciate the demographic and ideological forces already rising up to feed it. Leahy's intuitive grasp of the synergy between media and politics had led him very early to what seems now an inevitable postmodern conclusion. Rather than continually dunning the media for coverage, it made far more sense to set up the campaign as a media arm in and of itself, engaged independently and from the start, not simply with selling a winning image, but producing that image for wholesale consumption. As Leahy's media strategist David Schaefer sums it up in hindsight, a lot of this stuff was brand new, the television thing and the rest, all of these bunnies coming out of the hat that no one around these parts had ever seen before. And this is a small section called Force Multipliers, Technology and Media. But before I do that, I just want to show you quickly a couple of photos. If I could do that, which I can't. Maybe Austin, while I continue reading. Force Multipliers, Technology and Media. Although Leahy and Marcel, great, that's great. Although Leahy and Marcel were slowly winning hearts and minds across the state, it was the fact that these far-flung efforts meshed so neatly with Bruhn, his campaign manager, and Dave Schaefer, another manager, their relentless image-making that rendered them ultimately so powerful. More to the point, it was Leahy's campaign's several technological advantages that enabled this often remarkably deft deadline-making coordination. In his car were not one but two dictaphones, one dedicated to campaign business and another deeded to work for the state's attorney's office, and a police radio with a telephone handset that allowed Leahy to be contacted anywhere within the state that its signal could reach. Now, in an era where I can call Japan very easily, it's tough to recreate the advantage shown in this shot. Leahy could speak and listen from his car. There's a section on the main debate that the two men had in which Leahy used information they got over his car phone in the hour before the debate to upset his opponent in a way that Mallory's campaign manager used the word, this was our oh crap moment. That information came via this phone. Granted, the police radio phone was designed for official business related to the prosecutor's office, and Leahy was generally very scrupulous about that distinction. But with reporters, the car phone principle was never black and white, but a more changeable shade of gray. The state's television and print reporters had long had both Leahy's unlisted home number and his car radio number, and they would occasionally use either or both to confirm breaking information. That had been true of stories when he'd been exclusively the state's attorney, and it continued to be true now that he was running hard for the Senate. Yet the GOP campaign's link with their candidate was never entirely reliable, which made for a certain inevitable frustration. Mallory had made the decision to focus on legislating, and that put him often in long meetings and hearings from which he could not be roused. Quote, there would be times when Dick just wouldn't be accessible. There was always a delay getting things back from Washington, end quote. This lag, along with Mallory's insistence that each major campaign decision have his own personal okay, made for a stop and start feel to decision making, even at moments where the pace of the campaign had accelerated dramatically. Quote, I can't remember anything we ever did, really, that didn't have his personal stamp on it, Toby Knox says. And then he asks Brian Harwood, can you? Harwood cannot. Leahy's technological edge wasn't limited to a superior and fast-moving communications network. He and Schaefer worked out a means for the candidate to speak to breaking issues, even while he was pumping hands in another part of the state. And this was called the radio actuality. Says David Schaefer, quote, when there was a hot story taking hold in the press, it was a way to get his voice on the radio. Patrick would record it, and then we'd call up the radio stations and play this thing to them throughout the day. And it was a little attack or a response going through all the various radio stations. It was so primitive when you think of the internet now and all the stuff that can be done, end quote. But the radio actualities, like the radio car phone, were delightfully novel at the time, and they took the campaign's production of image to a slightly higher level. Rather than prepping the candidate to field queries by editors and producers, Brune and Schaefer also offered up their own pre-recorded sound bites shaped to provide answers on a range of issues, but these were answers cut at a certain angle to fill holes in later stories that the responses would themselves suggest. And thereby, one might argue, the team had moved very subtly and almost invisibly into reverse engineering the media's questions and stories themselves. Reporter Candace Page, looking back on the relationship between Leahy and the press, describes a natural rapport based on youth and personality. Quote, I can't emphasize enough, the demeanor was everything. Leahy was a young, energetic, not stodgy guy, and political reporters tend to be young, energetic, and not stodgy. So we sort of spoke the same language in a way that Dick Mallory just did not. So this is Dorothy Todd, the filmmaker that I'm going to come to in a minute. But what I want to capture with these photos, how young Leahy is and how gung-ho he is to exploit every single technological advantage he can find. So the fact that he adds a working documentarist to his sedan that already has two dictaphones, a phone, and the radio actualities, he has what will amount to a moving studio throughout the highways and byways of Vermont. The harsh truth of the camera, though, is that when it's pointed in one direction, it's not, by definition, pointed in another. The media's acquired taste for their opponents' crime stories and tough talk generated endless frustration and agita within the Mallory campaign. To counter the top cop image inside their own headquarters, Mallory staff eventually adopted a mocking nickname for Leahy, Claribel, the bald, horn-honking clown from the old Howdy Doody show. Their candidate might be occasionally unreachable in Washington, the nickname was meant to suggest, and he might be visibly uncomfortable on the campaign trail, but at least Congressman Richard Mallory wasn't out there every night blowing his own damn horn on Channel 22. That's the end of that snippet. And this is the last snippet built around Dorothy Todd and her film that you saw a little bit of earlier. So this is one shot of them out in the Northeast Kingdom. Here's another. This is City Hall Park in Burlington. So a great deal of the campaign was simple retail politics, shaking hands. I had a great interview with the senator and Marcel, and Marcel gave me this wonderful detail where they would be out all day at 10 or 15 events. They'd be on their way home, it would be dark, Leahy would be sleeping in the passenger seat, and she would go by a store or a school that had a light on and a crowd of five people out front. She'd swing in, wake Leahy up, and they'd shake the five hands. Now, you have to realize he wins ultimately, just to spoil the election for you, he wins by 4,000 votes and a little more. So the combined five votes outside the school over the course of 7 months is the margin. So this is about the Leahy-Walton film. For all their various tones and shapes and sizes, there are only two types of candidates when all is said and done. Those who campaign as though it's a fact of political life, and those who campaign as though their lives depend on it. Loss is a very real sort of emotional death to this second sort. And for that reason, it's impossible to miss them in a crowded field of candidates. Not only do they outwork their opponents on a day-to-day basis, not only do they project a more coherent path to victory, or more often, several paths, but they simultaneously and secretly reverse engineer a series of powerful defensive bulwarks against defeat. In a word, they firewall. And Leahy was no exception. Rather, his 1974 firewall would thereafter determine the outermost limits of the rule. Leahy's get-out-the-vote operation was superior to any the state had seen since 1962, when the Kennedy wave had brought young volunteers flocking to the Hoff campaign, and that was some real comfort. But as Leahy drove the state's highways and back roads in those final days of the Senate campaign, this was after the devastating Naramore poll, he could also tell himself with some grim satisfaction that he hadn't waited for disaster to strike in the final week of the campaign. He had imagined that disaster very clearly months before and taken steps to construct a highly elaborate firewall, a 30-minute primetime campaign film produced for television entirely by the campaign team itself and designed to boost Leahy's poll numbers radically in that final week. The idea was to introduce the candidate, to show him among his family and in friendly settings, to control the media frame entirely for the space of 30 minutes, and then, of course, to repeat those same 30 minutes six or seven times to saturate the target audience. The last time I can think of this being done was Barack Obama in 2008. He had huge amounts of money, and he actually broadcast a half an hour in prime time. But between then and now, there's not much in the way of that technique because it was unbelievably cheap, and after this success, it ceased to be so. It was a bold concept, though not entirely original. This particular political art form had been pioneered and developed by filmmaker Charles Guggenheim, among others. Guggenheim made several similar films for Senator Howard Metzenbaum and eventually George McGovern, and might have as much as a $100,000 budget to operate with him. But when consultant Joe Rothstein suggested a half an hour film to the Leahy operation, it was clear that it would need to be done on a relative shoestring. Of the $13,500 eventually spent on producing and airing the film, only about half actually went into the production itself, Warren-based documentary filmmaker Dorothy Todd eventually made what she still calls the Leahy-Walton film on 16mm for just $7,000. Still, the overall economics of that 30-minute chunk of airtime were compelling. WCAX, for instance, was charging the Leahy campaign nearly $2,000 for 9 30-second spots and 6 60-second spots. But by contrast, they were willing to part with an entire half-an-hour block in primetime for just $854, less than half the price. Todd had bought a house in Warren in 1970 and was, in her own words, quote, pretty new to Vermont, I would say stupid or impressionable or whatever. But she was not inexperienced. She'd been working in the New York cinema verite world for years and had only recently finished working with Sesame Street, where she'd created very brief live-action films to provide transition between Jim Henson's early Muppet sequences. The assignment for the Leahy film, arranged through Rothstein, came just in the nick of time, financially speaking. Todd still says wryly of her operation, there's a real threat of poverty that goes through the program here. Once she'd gotten the bare bones of the script, mostly in the form of a list of short interviews between Leahy and representative constituents, Todd was free to work as she saw fit. And she saw fit to use very little in the way of scripting. She wanted to move around with the camera, follow Leahy, and capture intimate moments. And she found a cameraman to match her style, Adam Gifford. For months, the two had followed Leahy up and down the state, Todd taking sound and Gifford with camera at the ready. But while Leahy gave her unlimited access and had been a solid booster of the film idea from the first, he wasn't a natural in front of the camera. Leahy's hundreds of hours speaking to the lens had all been done in highly scripted formats. Television news hours, on-camera interviews at crime scenes, debates with rigid rules and time limits. Todd's approach was more or less the reverse, and at first it was an awkward fit. He was, I'd say, a little uncomfortable on camera. He needed a prop or something. David Schaefer was a good prop. He could play off Dave or Marcel, but he needed the camera sometimes as a prop too. That way he could go in and take pictures and be present but not be the focus. So to me, he's a somewhat removed character on film. And so partially via inspiration and partially via necessity, Todd hit upon the film's disarmingly casual structuring device. Leahy, driving his battered sedan down a long Vermont road, speaking softly to the camera positioned in the passenger seat. And you saw that in that passage that I showed you. Other than an occasional glance at the camera, the candidate, of course, had to keep his eyes on the road. The steering wheel and the oncoming traffic thus became his prop. Best of all, the setup allowed Leahy's conversational style the time and space it needed to come through to listeners, as it invariably did in personal appearances. And it's worth noting that for the sedan itself, Leahy's own battered yet technologically enhanced Batmobile, this was a quantum leap. In addition to its two dictaphones and two-way radio handset, the car was now quite literally a fully operational film set as well, capable of producing image wherever it traveled or en route with equal ease. It was the apex for a campaign that had thus far managed to co-opt or bypass much of the traditional media apparatus. Only the lack of a suitable antenna and a broadcaster's license prevented the Leahyites from dispensing with the media altogether. To watch the opening of Todd's film today is to realize immediately why so many Vermonters would have been engaged by it in the final days of the race. It functions almost precisely like the opening of a 30-minute detective drama, a cop show like Dragnet or Adam 12, the sort of show that might be in reruns during the 7 p.m. slot the Leahyites had their eye on for broadcast. When the film's title comes up in white below Leahy's face, Senate 74, choosing a new leader for Vermont, it might as well be the title sequence of a Jack Webb crime drama, an effect heightened by David Schaefer's sober narration. This year we will choose a new senator for Vermont. This is the story of the 1974 Senate campaign, Vermont's people and their problems, and one candidate, Patrick Leahy. Like Dragnet's tag, the story you are about to see is true. Schaefer's words frame the film as a true story, but more primarily as a story, as entertainment, of the sort that viewers were accustomed to enjoying in the hour following their dinner and between their local news. During the course of these 30-minute segments, the film would eventually run in primetime on five separate television stations. Pat Leahy became not simply a character with whom viewers were familiar, but a de facto hero in a real-world drama, one that purportedly featured their own trials and troubles as well. And predictably, it was this highly effective narrative stitching, the segments with Leahy chatting behind the wheel, that elicited the most derision from the Mallory camp. Quote, "It was highly unusual. Leahy did a half an hour," Harwood says today, waving a hand, "in the car, kind of a recitative about what he thought about Vermont and what it ought to be and all of that stuff." End quote. Marcel, invariably described by print reporters as pretty or attractive, needed little fashioning from Todd. There is an almost palpable presence when the camera focuses in on her, describing her early attraction to Pat Leahy. It was something Todd saw from the first. Quote, "Marcel was just very easy to work with. She had a star power and a charm and a smoothness that you could just see was totally necessary for him." She talked about their whirlwind courtship in the film, blushing as she did so. And the family, from Leahy's grandparents to his youngest children, took center stage as well. Black and white still photos of Leahy's stonecutter grandfather, of the Leahy press, and of Leahy himself as a boy dressed with a jack-o'-lantern head for Halloween. Viewers could be excused for forgetting that the election was supposed to be a referendum on inflation and Vietnam and corruption in Washington. The Leahy-Walton film, Todd says now, laughing softly at herself, "That's how I always remember us all referring to it." The Waltons, of course, had begun a 9-season run on CBS just 2 years earlier, and the show's credits, which always involved the many Walton sons and daughters saying goodnight to the closing strains of a harmonica, had already become an equally long-running and affectionate joke in the popular culture. That's not to say that Todd's film is a Hollywood production. Far from it. The production values, in line with the budget, are low. As the Free Press would diplomatically phrase it, quote, "Generally, the documentary film has an unrehearsed appearance, and one of its few technical difficulties is occasional jumpiness that may have been caused by splicing," end quote. Still, the film does have a real charm, much of which lies in the few strands of what can only be called Hollywood tinsel, its occasionally open embrace of television's ubiquitous dramatic framing and celebrity culture. In this way, the made-for-TV campaign film was precisely the sort of early postmodern innovation that Richard Mallory was incapable of embracing, Patrick Leahy was incapable of refusing, and hence one last clarified distinction for voters choosing between them in the final days of the campaign. No one's going to watch a 30-minute commercial, Harwood reassured his troops, none of whom relished Leahy's sudden after-dinner dominance of their family television screens. And if they did watch, Harwood hastily added, they'd likely be miffed that their favorite game shows had been pulled in favor of some politician's horn-blowing. This, the Mallory folks agreed privately, would be the final downfall of Claribel, the moment when Patrick Leahy's hunger for the media spotlight would, at long last, consume him. Thank you. So I think we're running just a little bit ahead of where we were going to be. So I'm happy to take questions should anybody have them. Garrison.
You have no idea how terrible the Naramore poll was. His idea of polling was to walk around the shoebox in the town of Salisbury and get 100 people with stuff in the shoebox and then count the ballots that way. That's what he called a poll. It was, we ranked it one as the 35th worst poll in America, in the study you did for the Free Press, actually, and pissing off Naramore intensely. But Naramore got so angry. Naramore was teaching at St. Michael's, of course, Patrick's a St. Michael's alum. He was so angry that Patrick had won. You know, it would just sputter. One would think about Patrick actually confounding his poll. But once again, it was a dreadful poll, and certainly a not in a league with the other states.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a long section on the Naramore poll because everyone who talks about that election agrees it was one of the top three moments. There was a headline in the paper that said, Chittenden poll dooms Leahy, in huge letters, which Pat Leahy still has in his office today. And it's his version of the Truman-Dewey misplaced headline. Yeah, Tom.
This is a pretty wonky question, but can you explain a little bit more about why you got such a cheap deal for half-hour blocks on local TV stations back
no.
then?
No. I can't. It makes no sense to me. If you total up, I think there were 9 30-second blocks and 6 minute blocks. So that's, 4.5 minutes and six. 10 and a half minutes cost twice as much.
Yeah.
And I think it was because the thinking was that you wanted to be at the end of shows. You didn't want to replace shows because people would get angry if you did that. So better that all the thinking was about how to come in at the end of their favorite show or the beginning of their favorite show. But the Leahy people, in a very out-of-the-box way, decided to simply say, what if we just move into that space for a half an hour? So think about it. Over about 9 days' time, you're sitting at your dinner table in Vermont, and you've just finished dessert, and you're expecting your favorite game show to come on or your favorite drama show. And here's people from Montpelier talking about Pat Leahy. You've heard of Pat Leahy, but you've never seen his wife. You've never seen his kids. And you get hooked in. So maybe over the course of the week, you watch that twice. That's an hour that tens of thousands of Vermonters watched. And if I had time to show you the whole thing, it's really, really engaging. It's very, Leahy comes across as absolutely civic-minded, sober. He's a young man, but he gives off the air of someone a little older and more experienced. Tough-talking prosecutor. That top cop image really came across for the first time. Now this is, I'll just show you a couple more photos here. This is a still from the film. Again, filming out in farm country. So at the same time that, I can't believe I've forgotten to mention this, but Sandy Milans is the photographer who gave me all of these photographs from this period. When I started writing the book, I was working on it, and I had decided to cover this election first. So I had about 20 pages written, and I started wondering, I wonder if there are any photos around dopey me, because I didn't realize that two blocks away from me lived Sandy Milans, who was the photographer for the Leahy campaign. And in a roundabout way, I found him, went to his house, knocked on the door. I said, you don't happen to have any photos from that period? He said, let me look. Maybe I do. So I sat down in his living room. He came out with a box of about 1,500 photos. And it was one of the most satisfying moments of my professional writing life to have this world that I'd been trying to recreate just come to life with literally 1,000 images. So I was only able to use some of them in the book, and others I can't use, but I'll show you a couple that I wasn't able to use. So this is the Leahy's campaigning in diners, and this is how they did it. If you think about when you see Pat Leahy today, you're seeing him at the end of a highly successful 42-year career. He's an unbelievably powerful figure. He's a very, very busy man. So when you see him at events, right, that are tightly scripted. But during this campaign, he was everywhere. At every gathering of 5 or 10 people, there were the Leahys. So I like this shot very much. This is the Chittenden magazine. I won't go into the whole spiel, but basically, when Patrick Leahy decided he wanted to create a campaign that was a media operation, Paul Bruhn was the editor of the Chittenden magazine. Sandy Milans was the photographer. Everybody who was on the Leahy campaign was putting out this magazine. So Pat Leahy became friends with them. Paul Brune and he began to put their heads together. Paul Brune folded the Chittenden magazine several months later, basically renamed the operation the Leahy Senate Campaign of 1974. Celebrity culture, Tom Jones came and did a benefit for Pat Leahy. I looked for video of this, but it just wasn't to be found. Or even a still shot of Leahy and Tom Jones would have driven my mother insane. This is Pat Leahy taking the concession call from Dick Mallory. Very late at night, as I say, the margin was 4,000 votes. At a certain point, Mallory's people in Boston were telling him that the margin was 500, and so he was inclined to perhaps ask for a recount. But after about an hour, the margin was just enough that, as I put it in the book, Mallory's very, very decent character immediately asserts itself, and he concedes and offers any help he can to Leahy. Paul Brune, David Schaefer, you see, and Marcel over his shoulder. This is at the victory party after the concession call. It's now about 3 a.m. The crowd has stayed there. They're incredibly drunk. I believe Professor Nelson was there. I won't say anything about his consumption. But I had a number of shots of this rally. It's just brilliant. I went with this one for the book, but the runner-up was this one, which, if you think about the fact that there had never been a Democrat elected to the Senate in 108 years, or 118 years, I'm sorry, and he's just been elected, look at it's almost like a religious event. The Democrats in the room just can't believe it. What is this thing, a successful Democratic Senate candidate? And again, this is the cover of the book. So any questions that I haven't gotten to? Bruce.
Well, I worked for Dick Mallory back then in Congress.
And the anecdote you sent me is in the book.
About the nerve gas?
Absolutely.
But I never heard, we never in Washington referred to him as Clarabelle. And I stayed friendly with Dick until he died.
Yep.
And I was quoted when he died as saying, Dick was everything you'd want in a public servant, but nothing you would want in a politician.
Right.
But there are two ironies. Brian Harwood would then go on to found Hayes Harwood Media Marketing Firm.
Yep.
And then...
And Toby Knox does focus.
Yeah. Me. But then another irony is, and I still think... This is perhaps the ultimate Vermont campaign spot was Dean Davis bailing out the boat in the 1970 campaign.
And, yep.
You know, he came, he pushed for a sales tax, the creation of a sales tax, pretty unpopular. We were having tough times. And I think the guy's name is Sam Shepard from Boston who did that film. He's also the guy that handed Mallory's media there. So there was some sense, but I mean, you were dealing with essentially a perfect storm. You had Pat Leahy who was running as for something when he was the state's attorney. You had Watergate. I don't know where Charlie Ross came out of nowhere to take on Dick Mallory in the primary from the left, because Mallory had said that the Saturday Night Massacre, you know, firing of Archibald Cox, could be an impeachable offense. And we thought he'd get challenged from the right, but he got challenged from the left.
And as I remember, he remained neutral and didn't endorse Mallory, which was an anecdote that Pat Leahy told me with Chuck Ross sitting beside him at the table.
There was some thought that people felt he encouraged Charlie to run in the primary, but I've never confirmed that. But I think you've captured a lot of things there. You also understand, too, the Jeffords people themselves. I worked for Jeffords before I worked for Mallory, and they were suspicious and rivals of Patrick as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it was interesting, but... I heard the Burlington returns at 20 of 8 that night.
Mm-hmm.
the party was down the old tavern or Capitol Plaza. And I went up to Dick and I said, you were a good guy. And he says, what do you mean? I said, I've just heard Burlington, you're going to lose. Mm. And he did. Burlington was heavy for Patrick.
And he was 3-1 in Winooski. Just a quick anecdote about Dick Mallory. When I was doing the book, I was fortunate enough to speak with Paul Brune, David Schaefer on the Leahy side, and also with Toby Knox and Brian Harwood, who are the campaign managers for Dick Mallory. And it dawned on me all of a sudden, I've spoken with Leahy, but Dick Mallory's still around. I should give him a call. So I called his house. Now, it hasn't been mentioned at this point, but I'm also in the state Senate. And we were working on the Death with Dignity bill at the time. Dick Mallory was a very strong supporter of that bill. So I call up and I get his wife and I said, hi, this is Phil Baruth. I was just wondering if Congressman Mallory was there and I could speak with him. And she said, yeah, he's stacking firewood. So we talked for about 5 minutes while he stacked firewood. And then he got on the phone and I told him about the project, and a lovelier guy you never would want to talk to. So he was super helpful. We made an appointment for the next day to speak. And then he said, as long as I've got you on the phone, I want to bend your ear about the Death with Dignity issue. And so we talked about that. I promised I would bring his message about it to the Senate. And then hung up and heard the next day that he had died. When we had the debate about Death with Dignity, I kept that promise and I passed on his message. That bill ultimately passed by one vote. I won't say that it was because of Dick Mallory, but it didn't hurt.
Earlier you said that the Leahy video was constructed as a story, basically, by the campaign. Do you think that might have helped him in that it nicely dovetails with the human desire to like conceive things as stories, like the narrative theory?
Absolutely. Successful politicians tell stories. I mean, that's the only way I would put it. And you know, when we talk about politicians lying, it's because stories are inherently narrative, and if you take it a step further, they're inherently fictional. And so you're looking to take real material and give it, you know, the satisfying emotional shape of a story. So I didn't read from it tonight, but the chapter that is about Pat Leahy's time as the state's attorney begins with me going to the office for my first interview with Leahy, and I begin to talk to him. And if you've ever talked with Senator Leahy, he is an absolutely masterful raconteur. So he began to tell me stories, and they're great stories because he's told them many times. But I could tell I was getting stuff that other people had gotten. And so I did this sort of off-the-cuff thing. I said, let's just jump back to 1966. You're installed as the state's attorney. When you look back, what's the case that you can't forget after all these years? And he closed his eyes, and with his eyes still closed, he said, Trevento. And the Trevento case was his first murder case. It was the murder of a 2-year-old kid from Essex. And it turned out to be one of the most mind-blowing cases. And I finally devoted 20 pages in the book to it because it so perfectly captures Pat Leahy, the young prosecutor, learning his craft on the job because he had no training in criminal law at Georgetown. And Hoff appointed him without asking him, really. He called him up and said he was Hoff's clerk. And he said, I'm appointing you tomorrow. You know, that's it. And so Leahy, with no experience, went on the job, and 2.5 months later, he's dealing with the murder of this 2-year-old boy. The other thing you would need to know is that the Miranda decision had just been handed down, and everybody was absolutely paranoid about mishandling evidence and having cases thrown out. So that became the way that I told about his life, because it was a great story to me, but it was a story that hadn't been polished up for to a high gloss. It was still that raw, powerful story. So to take your point, yes, absolutely. I believe humans communicate in stories. and politicians are, in some way, especially effective with those stories.
I was going to quip, but I thought he might have said defending skinny dippers in the quarry, which got a whole lot of press around here.
That's in the book as well.
But you haven't really mentioned that Tom Salmon, 2 years before, had broken the mold. And he was running again at the top of the ticket in 74.
Yep.
And so I think that Leahy had a little bit of drift on that one.
Yep.
That's just my comment. And you didn't mention him tonight, but whatever their later relationships were, at that point, Salmon had won statewide as a Democrat, was winning a second time.
Yep.
And there was a somewhat of a different demography here.
Right.
As the current historical societies programs demonstrate. That's all.
No, absolutely true. And in the longer version of this, I do a little bit more contextualization. But you're right, absolutely. Phil Hoff is the real pathblazer. And Pat Leahy comes along after Salmon and Hoff. And that Irish political solidarity is part of what allowed. Yes.
And I've said enough. Phil, Tom was very envious of Patrick, mm-hmm. And always felt that he had let Patrick run, that he's the one who should have run in 74, and that he had stepped aside for Patrick so that Patrick could run. And then when Tom ran in 76 against Stafford, he was very upset that Patrick gave him minimal support. Because Bob Stafford, to his enormous credit, I was on the staff at the time in Washington, and Bob Stafford's people worked very closely with us, and they socialized us in how to be U.S. Senate staff. And so Patrick was incredibly loyal to Bob, and so Bob ran in 76 for re-election, and Tom hoped for help from Patrick. He didn't get it, and that was part of the rivalry.
Yeah, Gary, I think you're right, and I've kind of forgotten about that. What really killed Salmon was Scott Skinner's primary.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah.
And just to put this into context, Pat Leahy is the Chittenden County State's attorney, and then he makes what we now call today the Leahy leap from there to Senate. And the only reason I think he was able to take the nomination was people didn't value it. They didn't think that there was really a decent chance for a Democrat to take that Senate seat. So Pat Leahy took it, valued it where others didn't, and I think he had the sense, given his own understanding of his own intensity, that he could do something with it.
Maybe one more film?
Sure. If there is any? Yeah.
One of the other cases I wondered if it came up, Beecher versus Leahy, which threw out the state's abortion law.
Yep.
Now, Senator Leahy, or State's Attorney Leahy, prosecuted the doctor in that case, and perhaps it wasn't clear that he was doing that on purpose. Did that come up during the, I'm curious, he's a Catholic. Did that come up?
I absolutely read about it. In writing this book, one of the things I say in the introduction is that if somebody's coming to it hoping for an encyclopedic or a comprehensive treatment of either his prosecutorial career or his Senate career in terms of committees, votes, et cetera, they'll be bitterly disappointed. Because to go back to the young man's question, what I've done is I've told stories that are chronologically coherent, but that are isolated. So that means I don't tell lots of other stories. So that's certainly one of them. The other thing that I really wanted to do, but my manuscript turned out to be 525 pages, and University Press of New England made me cut 100. But I also don't deal really with Sotomayor and Kagan, the justices that Leahy helps usher in when he's chairman of Senate Judiciary to the Supreme Court. So that was a chapter that I really wanted to do, and I had a couple of other chapters, but it just got to the point where I couldn't publish a two-volume. Nobody would buy it, I don't think. So I have what I have. It's about 350 or 375 pages. So, but yes, absolutely. That's one of his most important early cases.
Well, particularly during that
to come up
because it was settled in 72.
On the other hand, I do the Paul Lawrence case occupies a number of pages. Paul Lawrence being a corrupt drug officer that Leahy puts together with some other officers, a sting, and they capture him and prosecute him in the final days of the race. Well, thank you very much, everybody. I appreciate it. And thank you to Richard Watts, who did a great job, to Austin for helping with the technical details.